Today we're going to go through some sample calculations on how to complete the reagent table for pre-lab. So what I have shown here is a table that I'm going to set up in my notebook for a given reaction. So we have this reaction of 2-bromoaniline is reacting with these various reagents and it's getting converted to 2-iodobromobenzene. And so you could see I've filled out in this table, I've listed all the reagents in my reaction, and I have a row here at the bottom for where my product is going to be. And the goal of the, one of the goals of the reagent table is to calculate the theoretical yield of your product. So I've listed the reactants, all the reagents, and any solvents that I use in the reaction. So pretty much this area here is going to be all the ingredients that go into my reaction. And then it's also very useful to include as the last line of my reagent table, the actual product that I'm forming. So this reagent table is kind of a one-stop shopping. When I need to go and look up any values during lab, I know where I can find that information. Now, what I pointed out here is the stoichiometry of the reaction, because it's impossible to do any of these calculations without knowing a little bit about the reaction and how it works. And so I just wanted to point out that the HCl acid is given in excess. And we're not going to calculate that today, but all the other reagents, these all are required to react in a 1-to-1 ratio. The 2-bromoaniline, the NaNO2, and the Ki all have to react in a 1-to-1 ratio in order to form one equivalent or one mole of the 2-iodobromobenzene. So that stoichiometry is important, and we need to know that before we can do our calculations. So what's in the amount column are the amounts that were given in my experimental procedure. So I just transfer those to that column. And then I can look up the molar mass of all my various reagents and my product. And I can also look up the density for any liquid reagents because sometimes it's useful to measure those out by volume. So we need the density for that. And then from this information, we can calculate the moles of each component, and then we can also calculate the molar equivalent or the molar ratios. From that, we can determine who the limiting reactant is, and that limiting reactant then will tell us how much we can possibly make of our product, how many moles, and then finally we can calculate the amount of the product we can get, which is our theoretical yield. So let's go ahead and start our calculations. Let's start with the 2-bromoaniline. It shows that we're starting with 2 milliliters of that. Now, how can we figure out how many moles that is? What we're going to do is we're going to want to use the density for the 2-bromoaniline because the density is in grams per milliliter. It tells us how many grams of that we have for every 1 milliliter. So by using the density now, I've converted that to grams. And then to get to moles, we can use the molar mass of 2-bromoaniline. By dividing by 172 grams, that's how many grams there are for every 1 mole. And so now my units will all cancel, and I'll end up with 0.018 moles of 2-bromoaniline, or in other words, 18 millimoles of 2-bromoaniline, and I can put that into my table. Next, I want to calculate how much NaNO2 I have in terms of moles, and I see that from my experimental procedure, I have 1.9 grams of NaNO2. And so again, I can use the molar mass to convert that from grams to moles, because I know every 1 mole of NaNO2 is 69 grams. So my units are going to cancel, and I get 0.028 moles of NaNO2. And finally, I'm going to calculate how many moles of Ki I have. And so we start with 3.6 grams of that. Again, the molar mass tells me that every 1 mole of Ki, I have 1.66 grams of Ki, so dividing by that molar mass cancels my grams and gives me 0.022 moles of Ki, or 22 millimoles. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to calculate the molar equivalents, or the molar ratios, because those are going to be easier numbers to compare than the actual mole numbers. So the way we do that is we determine which amount of moles is the smallest number, and we're going to set that to be 1.0 equivalents. And then we're going to divide each of the other numbers by that lowest number. So 18 millimoles is the smallest number, And so to calculate the equivalence of NaNO2, we're going to divide 0.028 by 0.018, and we'll get 1.6. And then the molar ratio, the equivalence of Ki, potassium iodide, is going to be 0.022 divided by 0.018, and we get 1.2 equivalents. So in other words, we could see now that both the NaNO2 and Ki reagents are going to be in excess, and these molar ratios now give us a clearer picture of just how much of each of these we have in excess. We have a 20% excess of the potassium iodide and a 60% excess of the sodium nitrite. So this is very helpful to know when we go to measure out our reagents on the balance. We know how precise we need to be, and also if we're going to maybe scale up the reaction or scale it down, we can use these equivalents to do those calculations a little more easily. And finally, we're ready to calculate the theoretical yield of our product. So we're going to take whatever reagent we have in the smallest amount, and that's the 2-bromoaniline, and we're going to set that as the limiting reagent. So because we have one equivalent of that, that tells us we can make one equivalent of the 2-iodobromobenzene, and that one equivalent corresponds to 18 millimoles. And now that we have the amount of moles of product that it's possible to make, we can use that to calculate the amount of product that's possible. So for the theoretical yield, we have 18 millimoles of 2-iodobromobenzene, and we can use the molar mass of that. We can multiply by 283 grams for every one mole, and we're going to multiply so that we can get our moles to cancel, and it's going to come out to 5.1 grams of the product. That's our theoretical yield. So we can put that on our table, and now when we run the reaction and we isolate our product and we find out how much we get, we can compare that to the theoretical yield to calculate the percent yield for our reaction. Notice too that in this last column, I forgot to mention, in this last column here, this is a nice place to put any other pertinent information about your reagents or reaction conditions that you want to include, any hazards you might have, melting points of solids, boiling points of liquids, and so on, maybe the manufacturer or any other comments that you have. So again, our reagent table at the end of the day can be kind of our one-stop shopping. Anytime we need to find information about our reaction, that's where we can go. So good luck with your reactions.